The Sherlock Holmes Advent Calendar. The Redeemer's Coming. By Sir Arthur Conan Doyle and Nora Godwin. Narrated by Peter Silverleaf. 9. The Questioning. After the violent death of the librarian, we individually invited all 24 friars to a police interrogation. Since time was indeed short, we had to have compact and concise conversations with each of them. There is no room here to write down every questioning in detail. That is why I will limit myself to a few exemplary ones. One of the first monks to speak to us in the abbot's office was Brother Paul. Lestrade had taken a seat behind the abbot's desk. Holmes and I sat on chairs on the left and right of him. The friars sat directly opposite to the inspector. Brother Paul was about 30 years old and reasonably overweight. His round face radiated kindness and a positive mood. He didn't seem nervous in any way, smiling at us almost constantly. "What was your relation to the deceased?" was Lestrade's first question. But Brother Paul remained silent and looked to the inspector only attentively, as if he was waiting for something. The Scotland Yard investigator's strict interrogation plan had already been thwarted. "I asked for an answer," Lestrade insisted, looking morose, but his request again was ineffective. "You don't seem to understand me, or do you not want to understand me?" the inspector continued. As the monk's lips remained persistently closed, I mockingly said, "Maybe he has made a vow of silence and is simply not allowed to speak." "A vow of silence?" Lestrade repeated, annoyed. "Such nonsense. This is a murder case. Open your mouth for the love of God." Finally, Brother Paul replied, "Maybe you want to clarify your question a little." The inspector's face first changed from anger to contentment, only to immediately turn back into incomprehension.
"Why?" he said.
"They spoke of the deceased," the monk replied. "I'm confused. So who are you talking about? Brother Emmanuel or Brother Nicholas?"
Lestrade stuttered. I have no idea. I mean," he stammered.
"Both. I meant both." I took a quick look at Holmes, who had been following the process wordlessly but apparently somewhat amused.
"Brother Emmanuel hasn't been with us for a long time," the monk began. "Personally, I didn't have much to do with him, because we mostly were assigned to different tasks. My main area of activity is the kitchen."
"He looks like it," I was inclined to think, but I was left wondering how one could be so well nourished on the basis of the meagre local food.
"Brother Emmanuel didn't have a clue about cooking," Brother Paul continued. "But other than that, he was a hard-working, energetic person, as far as I can judge. He also offered his support when he heard that we had only recently lost our kitchen help. But the young man simply had no talent for this. His creations were inedible. Within one day, the abbot instructed him to carry out other activities for which he was more suitable."
"It must have certainly annoyed you," Lestrade suggested, "when Brother Emmanuel spoiled your food, didn't it? Did you want to take revenge on him?"
Brother Paul giggled in a strange way, but the inspector's absurd remark deserved no other reply. "Of course I was furious," he said. "I couldn't help but kill him in the toilet immediately."
"Aha!" shouted Lestrade triumphantly. "Is that a confession?"
I twisted my eyes and shook my head demonstratively. I don't think so," I quickly explained. "That statement was sarcastic." It took a while for the inspector to understand that he had been made fun of. This is a police...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.